today I'm laying some Palio Clic flooring from Karndean. Now this is a high quality flooring, it's got all the attributes of Karndean flooring, but it's easy to lay. It's really designed for general builders, people like me who aren't floor layers, aren't sticking the stuff down. We want a very easy system, but it's also got to look good. Now the first thing I do in a room like this is to check the length, check the width, and make sure that when I start, I'm not going to finish up with any tiny silly little short lengths or anything like that. So setting the flooring out, finding out what kind of cuts you've got where, makes a big difference. It can save you an embarrassment in the future and also a lot of work. Now this is an occupied room, so it's not going to be easy. We've got to work around things, we've got to move furniture over, but we can get our first straight runs in. I've run a datum line all the way down the room so that we can check that the floor's square on the walls, because as you walk in the door, the last thing you want to see is the floor running out at an angle not parallel with the wall. So we take that, we do what we call our crown row. So we've made a bit of progress now. It's a little bit tricky when we started just getting them lined up, but we've done a nice long run. This is a very long room. This is around 10 meters. You can go for a maximum of 15 meters before you need to put an expansion gap in. So we're well in with that. We didn't really want to put a threshold strip here, which would have made life easier because we could have done it in two bites, two sections if you like, but we wanted that look when you look from the front door all the way through and it's a continuous uninterrupted floor, which I think everybody likes. So it's great that you can actually do that, but it does create a little bit of a challenge here because now we've got to run back into this bit, and rather than working with our tongues out as we were there, we've now got to reverse the process and work the tongues in from the back. So it's actually not that hard to do. So long as you lift them, you can do it. What's going to happen when we get to the wall is we're going to have to lift that last one, pop it in, and then push it down, and hopefully that'll be all right. But the good news is we've got a skirting to cover it, so it's not critical. The skirting is around 12, maybe 15 millimeters thick, so it gives us a little bit of leeway. We've got enough to push that one in. So it's a very simple principle. It just interlocks and clicks together like that. I'll show you on a full length so you can see what's involved, because there's a little trick that makes it really easy to do. And if you don't know that trick, it can take you a lot longer. So that's the principle of fixing it. But let me just talk about this screed first of all. We've had this self-leveling screed laid down because you don't really want a rough floor. You want to make sure that you've got a reasonable floor to lay on, and if you haven't, do a little bit of smoothing out first. So in this case, we've got an ideal floor. We can put it down. There's not going to be any ghosting through of anything underneath, and it's nice and flat. So we don't even need that foam underlay that you see with some laminates. This will sit down, and it's suitable for underfloor heating. This room has got underfloor heating. We've put a probe in because you need to monitor the temperature of the underfloor heating to make sure that you don't go above, say, 28 degrees centigrade. But it's a nice even heat, nice gentle low-level heat that we've got here, so it won't cause any problems. So let me just show you how to cut a piece, and then once you know how to cut one piece, you know how to cut them all. This is a concave blade. You also get hook blades, so make sure you get the right one. This is concave, not hook, and it just makes it easier. You can cut it with a regular straight edge blade, but I find that the concave blade sits in there nicely and just kind of establishes it. Now, if you're not used to using a knife, you might want to wear some cut resistant gloves, but I work on using my brain to make sure that I'm never cutting towards my hand. So you can see that one simple cut. We don't want to do several cuts. We'll just do one good cut like that, nice and controlled. And then if you watch what happens now, it's a simple question of score and snap. So when it comes to cutting along the length, if you like, same thing, let's keep our hand out the way and we'll just keep moving to keep it firmly on there as we're cutting, And then you can see this is just a bit harder because obviously you're working with the length, but you'll see what happens once you get that cut there. Once you get that started, you'll just be able to do that. Yeah, obviously as you get thinner, you might need to get a pair of pliers to do it, but the thing to do is try and avoid cutting small pieces. You can avoid having to do silly little slithers quite a lot of the time. So we spent quite a long time working all this out because we've got a big room, it's going through to the hallway, and we wanted to make sure that we didn't finish up at any of the doorways having to do small cuts. The general rule is that you never cut a bit shorter than the width of the board. So in other words, if it's square, that's okay, but if it's less than square, try to avoid it. Actually, what I like is about 300 millimeters. So in this room, we actually started by putting a full length in. We worked out how the cut was going to come on the end, and the convention is that you just work your way along, and the off cut that you finish up with from that end, so long as it's long enough, you can use it on the next one, so you don't waste any. But in this particular case, because we were working with a furnished room, we wanted to complete a section of the floor, so we kind of nominated where our cuts were going to go so we could work across the room. But that's just because we had a fitted kitchen in here and all sorts of stuff. Now we've got rid of a sink, now we've got rid of a cooker, we're going to complete the room, and I'm just going to get on with it, and if there's anything I think you need to know, I'll stop and tell you about it. Okay, here's my top tips, if you like. First thing, look after your knees, because if you're down on your knees all day long, you really need some kind of knee pads. Now, these Snickers work trousers, built-in knee pads, but if you haven't got these, get yourself a pair of those knee pads that you just strap on, because it will save you an awful lot of pain. The next thing is, the most important tool that you're going to have in this job is a vacuum cleaner, because you really need to keep this floor spotlessly clean. Even a tiny bit of grit or something, a little tiny bit of debris under there, when you go to put the tongue in the groove and there's a bit of dirt in the way, it will never close up. So make sure that it's spotless. Just keep vacuuming up. It's not that hard to do. My third tip is that when you get the lengths out, just have a quick check that there's no damage on them, because they're pretty well packed, but we did find a couple where obviously one of them packed maybe hit by a forklift truck or something in the delivery, maybe, you know, in the couriers, and there was a little chip in the end. And what you don't want to do is get the whole floor laid and then spot that imperfection. If there is a tiny chip, you can usually use it at the end where you've got a cut, so just put them to one side, don't throw them away, and you will find somewhere in the job where you can use that one. So let me just show you how these go together. We're always working with the tongue out because it's just easier to interlock them. So we work with the tongue out, the groove in, and we push that end in there. I usually just flex it up slightly, bow it up, so that you can just get it in there and then flatten it out, and then you've got a nice mating surface there. Now you'll notice there's a gap here. Don't worry about that gap. We'll take care of that in a minute. Now I'm going to move around here, and the reason I'm going to move around here is because it's good to have your weight on the flooring that you're pushing into. Once you've got a few pieces up, you can't always do this, but if you can, it helps. And then we angle it up and we feed it in there on that line. And then we just carry on down. As you can see, I've still got it angled up. I'm feeding it into that groove. And as we come up to the end, it's lifting the previous one as well, which you want. And you'll see that we just find that just the slightest tap in there, and you get that nice satisfying click. Put it down, check it, and it's absolutely fine. Now, every four rows or so, you may find that you need to just take an off cut and just very gently tap it in with the off cut and a hammer, just to make sure that the thing's all closed up. But just keep an eye on it as you're working. Keep an eye that you're not having any little gaps there that will eventually cause the whole thing to run out. This is very, very precisely cut, this floor. So if you keep it right, if you keep all those tongues in the grooves firmly locked in, you won't have any trouble. But don't rush it. That's the thing. If there's two of you, it's much better because you can watch each other work as quality control on each other. Well, that's a very satisfying job. I've got to say, Stephen and I enjoyed that quite a lot, actually. And even though these bits are behind the units and behind the cooker, we still took our time to get those absolutely right, because there's just something satisfying about doing the job perfectly, even when people can't see that bit. So it's done now. All we've got is a utility room and the downstairs cloakroom to do, which is all cuts, all fiddle, but fortunately, because we've got a wall-hung WC, we don't have to do that cut around the WC pan. I wouldn't fancy doing that. But there you are, very simple job. Now, what have I learned? What have we learned since we started doing it? We've learned that you have to angle each board up to get it in absolutely right. Don't try forcing it, don't try hammering it. If you get the angle right, the thing just slips in very, very nicely. And also, when you're joining the ends, lift it up, put it in, lay it down, ease that end in, and then the whole thing will come as easy as anything. If you're forcing it, it's because there's something wrong. So just an idea is to just check the previous row before you do the next row. Just run your eye along, and if you can't see any gaps, any, you know, traces of the sort of the tongue and the groove not quite meeting, if it looks good, then you can continue with the next one. But it's good to sort that out. If you do find it's drifting apart slightly, sort that one out before you do the next one. So I hope that that's inspired you to have a go at laying Palio Clic from Karndean. They've also got Palio Core, which is a more cushioned thing, which is great for bathrooms and things like that. And they also do a loose lay, which you lay in to the skirting boards. We've got a video on that, if you'd like to see that, on Skill Builder. That's up and running. So come back and see us soon. Don't forget to subscribe if you're not a subscriber. We love to have you. And if you press that little bell in the corner there, we'll notify you of when we've got a new video coming up. And there are a lot in the pipeline.